Good morning to a slightly damp sunrise safari. My name is Brent Neersmith. I have VM on camera. We have Jamie and Dangerous Dave out on the other vehicle. And we have Geraldine and Louise in final control. So the lions were roaring almost all night last night. Different groups of lions. There were some in the north, which I presume to be the Salati males. And it sounds like the Birminghams might have split. Some of them stayed around that buffalo carcass. The others seemed to march east down Gowrie Main. So, as you can see, I don't know if you can actually see, but there's a fine little drizzle that's falling at the moment. There we go. So hopefully it doesn't get any harder and we're able to stay out as long as possible. So Jamie is heading down towards the south and west to see if she can find those lions that were making such a racket last night. And I'm heading to the northwest to start looking for the possibility of a Mvula or Karula again. So exciting stuff, possible multiple cats on property. Otherwise, there's always lots of wonderful and interesting things to have a look at. And don't forget, if you're wondering about what we're seeing out here, pop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv. or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Well, let's get going and see what's out in this damp morning. Lady Luga has been up bright and early and she heard the pearl-spotted owlet on the Juma cam. And for those of you who don't know what that sounds like, it sounds something like this. Wonderfully pretty call that we do hear quite regularly out here on Juma and Arethusa. Julianne says, can you imagine hearing lions while you sleep all night? Well, Julianne, we do. And yes, it is absolutely awesome. It is one of those wonderful sounds. All the cacophony of nighttime sounds, the owlets, the lions, the hyena, the occasional leopard. We actually had a big herd of elephants feeding around our room last night. So the breaking of branches, the low rumbles, and the occasional squeal and trumpet of a chastised youngster. And it is amazing how at night you can hear so much more and it is so much clearer because there's not so much stuff making a noise. But the nighttime animals that do make a noise tend to make quite a big one. A little diker in the road. I'm just turning off my lights. Pirate Jack says today is the day we find Karula. I hope you're correct there, Pirate Jack. I would be absolutely ecstatic. In the distance, I can just hear over the vehicle sound, one of the last nocturnal callers, the fiery-necked nightjar. Deanna says she would love to be awakened by the sound of an elephant trumpet. Well, it depends, Deanna. They do it at 3 a.m. very loud outside my window. I do feel the need sometime to go, hey, I'm still sleeping. Can't you just wait an hour? Starry Night said this is my first morning adventure with Safari Live. Well, good to have you on board. Hopefully we can match your excitement with lots of animals. So let's go see Jamie so she can bid you a morning and tell you how her lion tracking's going.
And a very good morning to all of you across the world. And welcome to our chilly and somewhat damp sunrise safari. It is very definitely mizzling, a combination of mist and drizzle on both Dave and myself as we head along, and I'm sure Brent and Liam as well. So a chilly start to the morning, but what's so exciting now that we're starting to go into winter and we've got these extended periods of darkness in which to drive, plus the cooler temperature, means that good morning Impalas, I'm coming past, sorry. And turn the lights back on, means that we can expect all kinds of exciting nocturnal sightings in the future. I know that Brent had the white-tailed mongoose and a civet last night. It's a relatively unusual sighting for the Wild Earth team. So exciting stuff in the air. Now I'm sure Brent has updated you since you were chatting a bit about the sounds of night in the African bush, that we heard the lions and probably the Birmingham boys moving sort of eastwards along our southern boundary last night. It was hard to tell, they were quite far away, so I couldn't tell if they were moving straight along the road or if they were slightly further to the south of that. Either way, I'm going to go and check up and see where they've headed off to. I'm just dropping the lights as we drive past herds of impala. I'm sure, as you can imagine, if you were fast asleep in the darkness of the morning and somebody came past you and shone a bright light in their eyes, in your eyes, you wouldn't be terribly impressed with them. I don't want to do the same thing to the impala. Sorry, boys. Good morning. Most of the animals enjoying a little bit of a lion, hiding out from the cooler temperatures and the drizzle of the morning. So yes, we heard the lions moving along our southern boundary, and I still want to solve the mystery as to where the Nkuhumas have gone. Haven't seen them in a little while, and nobody's seen them in a little while. Wonder where they've decided to move off to, if they've gone into Buffers Hook, maybe even into Manuleti, which they do occasionally go to. Both of those places are to the north of our boundary. If they've just been hiding out on Juno somewhere, because we haven't seen any tracks leaving the property, so it'll be interesting to know. Oh, rain's a little bit harder. It'd be very interesting to know where those lionesses have snuck off to. I'm sure you're all as curious as I am. The one thing about this weather is that it has grounded the vultures for a large extent, a large part of the day. Because it is so cold, they can't find any of the hot air currents to give them that thermaling ability. They're spreading their wings and riding the rising air. I did see one or two moving about quarantine, and I've just seen one now that was fast asleep in the tree. Didn't want to shine the light on him though for too long. That might be that the Nkuhumas have a kill hidden up somewhere in the vegetation that we just haven't managed to locate yet. If they do, though, they've been very quiet about it. I imagine that Brent also updated you about the elephants chasing things. Oh, darn it. Cheryl in California has said that she doesn't often enjoy creepy crawlies, but that she found the dung beetle sighting that we had yesterday absolutely fascinating. And Cheryl, I did as well. I thought it was so entertaining. For those of you who missed it, we watched a dung beetle from start to finish, from the point that he sort of had rolled his dung ball and had a female attached to it. We watched him roll it across the road, find an appropriate place in which to bury it, and proceed to put the entire dung ball, which was about the size of just smaller than a tennis ball, dig it below the surface. And the reason I'm sort of cross with myself this morning is I once again forgot the book that I meant to bring, with a picture of what those, a cross section of what those dung balls look like. Nevertheless, it was hugely interesting and hugely educational to spend time sitting watching that. Again, good morning, Impalas. Just to watch the way in which he went about this whole process of digging the dung ball underneath the surface of the soil. And the fact that one of our viewers picked up on that, he moved in a clockwise, he dug in a clockwise direction the whole time. And then just watching the female's behavior and trying to guess at what her role was in this whole deal. Hugely interesting. And it's moments like that that are very important in the bush. And Andrea, who's watching on YouTube, she said, wait a second, can these people see our chats? Yes, Andrea, we can see your chats. The awesome thing about that is you are welcome to say whatever you like, but you are also welcome to ask us questions. And you're welcome to make comments on whatever it is you're seeing. That's one of the big draw cards. You can think of it almost as if you are on the back of the vehicle with us, like you would be able to ask your guide a question in a real live safari. So please, Andrea, you are welcome to send through any questions or comments that you have to make. If you want to know where we are, for example, we are driving along at current on Gowrie Main, the southern boundary of our little section of 4 million hectares worth of unfenced wilderness area, a place that's remained as a conservation area for the last 100 or so years. The Sabi Sands, a little bit less than that, but nevertheless, animals existing as they have in the wild for that entire time. And we've got a little section of it known as Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands that we get to go along. We've got a wide variety of animal characters to share their stories with you. Anything from lions to leopards. Our lovely resident female leopard, Karula, known as the Queen of Juma, has two tiny little cubs. We haven't managed to see them properly yet. And in fact, I haven't managed to see them at all. But nevertheless, we know that they are out here somewhere, waiting for her, or waiting for them to be old enough to come out into the open. And then, of course, the other variety of anything from impala to elephants to cheetah to spotted hyenas, all are a possible sighting we could have. This is a very chilly way to start one's morning. Now, yesterday afternoon was an exceptionally exciting afternoon with Brent as well as myself, but Brent had that incredible sighting of Mvula, a large male leopard that used to be very much dominant in this area. He's now been pushed a little bit further and further east each day by another large male leopard known as Tingana. But yesterday Brent had an extraordinary sighting of him stalking buffalo calves, which is incredible. That is exceptionally rare to see. But moving very much in the same area as Karula was as well. And Doug was just a little bit concerned and was wondering, is Mvula a threat to Karula's cubs? Probably not, Doug. We know that Karula has been seen mating with Mvula in the last few months. There's always the possibility that he is the father of her first set. And that, of course, is why female leopards demonstrate that seemingly promiscuous, it's the wrong word to use, but seemingly promiscuous behavior in terms of mating with as many males as they possibly can. order to ensure that each male in this area thinks that the cubs are hers. She was even seen mating with Kajima, that mystery male leopard that started moving into Biffles Hook, around Biffles Hook Dam, and has only really been seen a couple of times. He's a very shy leopard. He's obviously coming from an area that is not the Sabi Sands. That is a leopard that has not seen all that many vehicles in his life, or if he has, they haven't been safari vehicles treating him with respect. He's a bit more nervous of our presence. He will relax, hopefully, in time. But either way, he could be the father as well, for all we know. We'll have to wait until those cubs are old enough and we can go and collect their scat and put it in a lovely vial full of silicone that will dry it out a little bit, and then send that off to Panthera. That Panthera are busy doing paternity tests on their leopards. Let's show you a sound. We'll just go backwards a little bit so we can point the mic in the right direction. Oh, don't stop. I was listening to the whistle of a grey-headed bushshrike, and it's one bird that I feel the Afrikaans name is far nicer. Let me just be quiet for a second. Did you hear that low whistling call? It stopped again. That is the sound of a grey-headed bushshrike, but I feel that the Afrikaans name is far more descriptive. In Afrikaans, it's known as a spookvoël, which is a ghost bird. The reason behind that is you often hear that eerie whistle, but you hardly ever see the bird responsible for making it. Don't you think that's just such a perfectly descriptive name of the way in which that, or the way that that bird sounds? It's an awesome name. Okay, continuing on. Oh, there he goes again. Beautiful call. It is a ghostly sound on a morning like this morning. Wonderful. Now we'll continue on along our way down Gowrie Main in the rain, looking for tracks of lions. So far I haven't seen any coming out, so they might be a bit further south. Nevertheless, we'd never know if they might have responded to the call of the Salati males further to the north and popped back across our boundary. So while Dave and myself continue on our somewhat damp journey, let's find out how Brent's morning is going.
It seems like the dampness is increasing. I'm definitely going to have to go home and bring out some of my winter gear. I feel the need for gloves this morning. Although most of you would consider it not too cold, it's 20 degrees Celsius, 68 Fahrenheit. But for us soft bush babies, we think this is quite cold and uncomfortable, especially coupled with drizzle. I mean, drizzle's not something we really get too often. We normally have it bucketing down, or not at all. On a positive note, the cats are generally, if they are going to be moving, they're going to be moving on roads or big paths. They don't like to get their toes wet in the dew. Hopefully, one just decides to pop into the road in front of us. So Karuda was lost just in here last night in this little system just to the north of our boundary. So I'm just checking very carefully now to see if she crossed back into Juma. I do have the feeling that, oh, elephants. Elephants in the mist. No gorillas, but just elephants. Now, Ellie's will love this way. There we go. Big grey behemoths in the mist. Now, Ellie's will love this weather. It's not too hot, nice and cool. They can walk around feeding. Nice herd. More coming across in front of us. Big herd. Lots of babies. Oh, look at that little one coming. I don't know if you guys picked that up on the mic, that there's a squadron of dung beetles flying in. Obviously one of these eddies has made a deposit somewhere close by. I'm just putting on the front rain pieces that gets a little bit harder. Right next to a lovely herd of Ellie's in the mist. At least when we're in the mist and not moving, we don't get quite as wet, so I'm quite happy. So I'm just closing up all my cases, cameras and things. So Linda is wondering, during the winter months, how cold can we get? So Linda, in all the years I've been coming to and from the Sabi Sands Game Reserve, I've only ever seen frost once here, so that's obviously just below 0 degrees, but I'd say in the early morning our average temperature is probably around, in the winter month, I'm just trying to work it out for you in Fahrenheit. This drizzle is coming in fast and furiously. Oh, it sounds like...
Ready for Jamie?
Well, I'll be with you in a sec. Standing by.
Range apparently four of those Birminghams went southeast toward Chikwa and Ngari side. There's also four Wangadora going north on close to Shabab Road.
Oh, that's good. Lovely, good luck. So there we go, update from Jamie. That there's a tracks of one of the Birmingham boars heading towards into Juma. The other have disappeared further to the south. These Ellie's are just disappearing. There we go. We're not going to follow them off road at the moment. Might let's just go around. Oh, not so good. That lion did a oop de loop, and he went back onto the southern edge of our traverse and is still moving east. Huge safari live welcome to Ellen and Angela. Angela is 5 years old and staying up over bedtime to watch safari live. Well, Angela, I hope you're loving the elephants, which apparently you are. Here we go. They're about to disappear into the bush, so we'll just watch their big, great grey bottoms. So this morning, you're going to notice VM's hand come across the lens quite often. He just needs to wipe the lens to get some of the moisture off. So lots of food around for the Ellies at the moment, and they'll be loving the fact that there's some grass to feed off. These guys look like they're not stopping feeding, they're on a mission. So Victoria in Murray would like to know how tall a baby elephant would be to a human. Well, a baby elephant under a year would probably come up just below my hip. So what's that? I'm 6'3", ooh, nearly 6'4". How tall you think that is? Fully my hip in feet.
1,000?
1,000 feet to my hip. So probably just over a meter. 1.3 meters at the shoulder, of course. Well, we'll let those Ellies move off. They're moving into a particularly thick block. Also a block that is renowned for gremlins. We don't want to have any gremlins jumping aboard and laying eggs. We're going to continue to the east. For those of you who might be wondering about gremlins, gremlins is a little joke we make when we do have signal breakup or technical difficulties. And then Jamie did a long explanation on the life cycle of gremlins a few safaris ago when my vehicle was beset with gremlins. And just so you know, there's two types of gremlins. There's a technological gremlin that feeds off... What does it feed off, Vim? The one that messes with the signal.
Yeah, it feeds off the
transmissions. It feeds off the transmissions and things between and up in the air. And then we have a mechanical gremlin, which obviously breaks the mechanical parts of the car and camera. So if you want to learn more about the life cycle of gremlins, go have a look at the Safari Live a Facebook page, and there's a little clip about the life cycle of gremlins. So we are looking for Queen Karula, and quite often if she does go into Buffalo's Hook, she sort of meanders her way back towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. And also another old favorite hangout of Mvula, who we saw on yesterday's sunset safari. And we're gonna see what's happening in that area. And you notice my head pop off the side of the vehicle. I'm in search of the footprints of leopards at the moment, and I will also keep a lookout for lions and other creatures. Jamie's got a lovely surprise for you, although the surprise might not be as happy and might not look as happy as we are to find it.
Look who we found in the middle of the road. I was busy chattering away to Dave about the tracks I was following east and that he'd gone off the road. We encountered this gentleman fast asleep. And he is just so fast asleep that he is positively not moving. Look how dirty he is as well. This would be the lion that is responsible for the calls that we heard during the night. But my goodness, what a dirty lion he is. Didn't even lift his head as I drove along. He was so still, I barely spotted him. In fact, I didn't. Dave was quite surprised when I suddenly slammed on the brakes and looked at me as if to say, he actually said to me, didn't you see that? I didn't. I was so busy tracking him, watching his tracks on the road and just thinking how fresh they looked. And I was saying to Dave, oh, they've gone off the road. Voila. That is just a lion sleeping off one belly full of buffalo. I wonder why he is so filthy. It looks like he's been lying in the stomach contents of the buffalo. You would think that by now, with so little that was left of that carcass, they would look a little bit cleaner. But he just looks positively bedraggled. Definitely not. He doesn't look happy, but I'm sure he's not nearly as bothered by the rain and the cold as we are. Let's just roll a little bit closer. Hello, boy. Oh, okay. All right. Good morning. You are awake, sort of. I'm sorry. Did you have a rough night in the rain? Or are you just so full that you can't be bothered to go and find the rest of your coalition? Apparently, as I'm sure Brent gave you that update, four of the Birmingham boys went further to the southeast of our position, so into this property known as Little Gowrie. They wandered down in that direction towards the Three Sticks females. They were there, apparently, but he's decided to straggle. We did actually get a question yesterday about whether or not lions ever separate from the rest of the group and move about on their own. And this is a perfect example with male coalitions of them splitting up. They were all united around the buffalo carcass, but then have gone their separate ways for now and patrolling. And they were definitely patrolling last night. That constant vocalization every sort of 5 or 10 minutes, calling to each other, contact calling to each other, but also calling to the rest of the lions in the area. And Penelope saying, don't you just hate it when you're driving along and there's a lion roadblock? I can think of worse ways to start my day. How do you feel, Dave? I feel as though that's a fairly reasonable way to start. But Penelope, I get exactly where you're coming from. Perhaps my morning traffic jam is slightly different to most other people in the world. All I can think of is that poor gentleman at the Birmingham boy sighting. When was that? Was it yesterday? It was the day before that, when we had them walking down the middle of the main road, and there was some poor gentleman in his white minibus, and all he wanted to do was get to somewhere else. He obviously had a vehicle full of guests that he was transferring, and he had to cruise behind the lions as they slowly padded down the road. I say poor gentleman, but I mean, it's a game reserve, and there are lions on the road. It doesn't get better than that as a start to the morning, in my opinion. Doesn't he just make for the most bedraggled picture you have ever seen? I've never seen such a scruffy, dirty, miserable-looking lion. He's probably not miserable at all. That's just me putting my human emotions on him. I just want to just call this in on the Game Drive channel. I've just realised that I haven't done this. Morning stations, 1 Madoda Ngala, static on Gowrie Main Junction, Weaver's Nest. Oh, big stretch. What I am going to do at some point, I noticed there's a vehicle that's been coming down the road towards us. We will reposition so that we're not sitting right in the middle of the main road, but for now, this is our best view. That actually looks like a really comfortable patch of sand, though. It's going to be... The Birmingham boys have been through the wars recently, whether it's been from fighting other male lions or whether it is from fighting internally. Either way, Scrapper's looking particularly thin, and Birmingham boy number 2, I believe, was the one that was limping very stiffly. Jennifer was wondering if perhaps this could be one of the injured lions. Could well be, Jennifer. None of the injured or thin-looking lions, so Scrapper, to me look like they are too serious in any kind of serious bother. That limp that the one Birmingham boy has, whilst it looks, whenever he gets up and it's a bit stiff, looks fairly serious, it will heal up, I think, relatively quickly. Might every now and again favour whatever leg is injured. But it's not going to be something that reduces their chance of survival in any way. Jennifer, it could be. I'm having trouble identifying which particular individual this is, just due to the fact that he is very much covered in stomach contents. That's the brownie muck that is all over his mane and his face. They've obviously made sure that they tucked into the last part of that buffalo carcass before they left it. Which is unusual for the Birmingham boys. They very often are so successful hunting-wise that they very commonly leave half-finished carcasses. But they made short work of that buffalo and her calf. I think that they were particularly hungry-looking. Hello, boy. Is this Birmingham boy number 3? I'm not entirely sure. I was having trouble with him. He just looks so scruffy. Might even be blondie, actually, beneath all that muck. James Richards has said he loves the way that animals just decide to take a nap wherever they happen to be, whether or not it's in the middle of the road. Absolutely. He's found the perfect spot to lie. And of course, he's picked one of the main access roads between the different lodges. And there's going to be vehicles coming and going throughout his morning. He was walking relatively rapidly, I noticed from his tracks. And we must have just missed the moment when he lay down. Because his tracks were showing through to the dry soil underneath on the surface of the earth, on the surface of the road. So that's how I knew his tracks were fresh, fresh, fresh. But I suppose when the whole world is your home, any spot is nap spot. Tammy and many others have suggested that perhaps he looks as though he's had something of a raucous night out and is now feeling the after effects of that. I agree with you. He does look reluctant to lift his head and even more reluctant to open his eyes. Even when he has lifted his head, he's sort of looked bleary at us. That being said, I mean, we have no idea what went on last night. I'm fairly certain that there wasn't any kind of confrontation between the lions of different coalitions. I think that they were just moving fairly constantly and that he took a slightly different direction to the others, just judging by all of the vocalizations that we heard. And I suppose, you know, when you have a giant meal, the last thing you feel like doing is going for an incredibly long walk afterwards. I suppose that might also factor in. His belly is very, very round. I'm glad to see that they have managed to have a proper meal. Hello, boy. If we're really lucky, the other Birmingham boys might call to him, stretching out his foot, and he might call back to them. Oh, so exhausted. Such a long night. People underestimate the amount of energy that male lions have to utilize in their day-to-day life. Now, he lifted his head in response to something, and it was not in response to us. And Natasha in Ontario was wondering How far can a lion see or hear? And I don't know whether or not he lifted his head in response to the calls of other lions. I don't think so, though, because I think he would have been more alert to it. So, Natasha, he could easily hear the calls of his brothers up to about 10-odd kilometres away, so just over 5 miles away, if not more, depending. It very much depends on the atmospheric conditions at the time. So the colder it is, the further the noise travels, and then the amount of moisture in the air will also affect it. And, of course, as you know, we are definitely not lacking moisture in the air at the moment. So that will determine exactly how far away he can hear and what he can hear, but certainly his hearing far more effective than yours or mine. His eyesight, on the other hand, the eyesight is very much attuned to movement. So whilst I wouldn't describe it as bad, it is not as strong as their ears or their sense of smell. They hunt as a combination, but as a predator, eyesight is still of vital importance. Now, his night vision is almost as good as we can see during the day, except not in colour. But his daytime vision is very much attuned to movement, which is why, one of the reasons why they always tell you, if you ever encounter a lion in the bush, you do not run. Even if he is upset to see you and making ferocious growly sounds, you still never turn on your heel and run away from him, because instantly that triggers a response to... Siberia Zumi would like to know if this is that disgruntled look, if this is what Brent looks like after a night of partying. I couldn't possibly comment, Siberia Zumi. I don't think that I would be forgiven for it. Certainly the hair is about the right length, let's say that, but he has yet to come home at any point covered in buffalo stomach contents, for which I am exceptionally grateful. And speaking of Brent and not being covered in buffalo stomach contents, let's find out how his morning is going.
So, in our search of leopards, we haven't even found a track, but I've just spotted some more ellies up ahead, or an ellie at least for now. We'll see if there's a few more shortly. There's that grey dot over there.
Morning stations, there's a report of two other Madonna Gala around Twin Downs Junction, Gowrie Main. So I have one here on Weaver's Nest Junction.
I'll make my way that side, thank you.
Looks like young bull. Sorry, I was just listening to the radio there. And that doesn't mean there isn't a breeding herd around as well. Could be hanging on the peripheries. I think I see more in the trees. Hello, weavy fence. Oh, there is some little, it is a nice little herd. This is a young bull on the edge. Hello, Ellie's. Granny Billy Joe would like to know, do elephants seem testier in the cold or in the rain? Not really. They're just elephants, as you can see, completely relaxed, ignoring us, feeding away. Oh yes, shake your head.
Morning.
quiet for a few seconds. So, a few days ago, and just before that as well, Jamie and I have both seen a young elephant that's got, looks like an abscess on its trunk. And Matthew in Michigan's wondering, do you have any more information on that? Well, Matthew, I had a closer look at the photograph I took, and I think it could be from an injury, from a sharp stick, or something that's protruded in there, but very difficult to say, as it has sort of exploded, and it is open. Let's just go. I want to have a quick look at this young bull. Hello, big boy. Not quite massive yet, but definitely over 20. Hello, mister. That's it, after the nice green grass. There's another Klambi of Ndlov on Cheetah Cutline, just to the south of Buffalo-Sokari Cutline. Merkel legend would like to know how tall adult elephants can get. So they can get very tall, and there are some individuals that are over 4 meters at the shoulder. But on average, for a male, probably around 3 meters at the shoulder. And a female is probably a bit shorter. So in So in this area, you're probably looking at between 4 and 3 meters on a male. And females probably about 2.8 meters, 9 feet. So just a bit shorter at the shoulder. Off he goes. And this guy's probably close, just over 3 meters in the shoulder, I would say. So not quite big. He's probably still got a little bit of growing to do. Deborah, the armchair traveller, says she's so happy they've got grass to eat after that really dry weather, and they're definitely taking advantage of it. So, of course, there's not going to be nearly as much grass as normal. We're right at the end of our growing season, so all the animals better take advantage now. It's still going to be a tough dry season, but at least there's water in the dams, and the trees will make a quick recovery as well. So hopefully there will be enough food around for all the animals come October. Let's go have a look what the rest of the herd is up to, whether they've scuffled off while we're going to look at this big boy. Oh, congregation.
Oh.
It's amazing how these big animals, you just go away for a second and a spot that was inhabited by four great grey behemoths is gone. I can hear them actually feeding away, but as Sammy on YouTube is wondering what's the oldest an elephant can get, Sammy, they can get to about 65 years old, but the biggest thing with them is that they lose their teeth, and they have sort of a big single molar, and when they get to a certain age, they go onto their last set of teeth. They normally get that last set of teeth at around probably early 40s. Some elephants have been known to live as long as up to about 65 years old, but most of them not that long. Here we go. Here's a nice little diagram of an elephant's tooth. So you can see. Now, these come in a circular motion up through the jaw. And that's quite an old tooth. You can see how dark and stained it is from vegetable matter and how it's been really worn down, so it's not that high. So when looking at fossils of elephants, that is often the most common thing found, is fossilized elephant teeth. I actually have a fossilized elephant tooth that I found in the bush before, in Zululand, but it is incredible that. I'm just gonna see if I've got a better looking tooth. This little drizzle doesn't help technology. Let me give it a quick wipe. Looks like it might be clearing a little bit. We might lose a bit of that drizzle. Hear that, Jim?
Mm-hmm.
I thought I heard an alarm call there, so we're just going to keep quiet for a second and listen. Nope, nothing else. So we're going to continue our search for other creatures and hopefully the Queen of Juma. While we do that, let's jump back to Jamie, who's still with that gorgeous but slightly unimpressed male lion.
Unimpressed and very full is how I would describe our particular male lion. Ooh, stretch. I love the way they stretch like that. Now, just to update you, there are two more Birmingham boys a little bit further to the east of us around Twin Dams Road. I just paid them a quick visit to check the sighting out. There are three vehicles there for now. So once they move off and continue on with their morning game drive, we will make an approach to the other two as well. There could even be more lions around Juma, for all we know. The other two Birmingham boys could well be here. Hard to tell exactly, with tracks crisscrossing all over the place. Just look at the size of that front paw. He's presented us with such a perfect view of it. You can see how large the toes are compared to a female lion or a lioness. Just the size difference. It's actually the proportion of the toes to the back pad, which also gives away a male lion's tracks. And what we will do when we have a chance is we will find a nice, perfect lion track to show you. You can see them where they've all walked along this road. I've just changed position for now to allow some of the other game drive vehicles to have a nice view of his head. His very dirty head, but his head nevertheless. Look at all the flies gathering around his belly. Now, looking at his somewhat rotund belly, nature is beautiful was wondering, don't they usually pant a bit faster when they have such full stomachs? And they do usually, but that is more or less during the hotter times of the day. He's not as full as he would have been last night, so already that digestion process starting to slow down a little bit. And the stomach not pushing as high up into his diaphragm, so restricting his lung capacity as well. But I think it's just because it's a bit cold and that he's had a couple of hours free from eating, that he's no longer panting quite so fast and just breathing normally. The temperatures have dropped considerably over the last few days. We're starting to feel the first chills of autumn. Although looking now, after starting off our morning in mizzly, drizzly rain, the sun is starting to, well, the sky is starting to lighten. And the clouds are blowing away and the weather is clearing. We'll have some sun soon, and then nature is beautiful. He'll probably start panting a little bit more. And complete your sort of sensory update, he looks incredibly dirty. Megan was wondering, does he smell like stomach contents? Is he a particularly smelly lion? Now, Megan, fortunately, with all of the dust that's blown up over the last few days, I am completely incapable of smelling anything. My nose is very blocked on this rainy morning. I think, honestly think it was from all that wind blowing about over, with particularly that very stormy night. My nose has been suffering ever since. Dave, is he smelly? No. I think also the rain, Megan, I think the rain has put a dampener on the smell. But as soon as it starts to heat up a little bit and this rain has stopped, he will probably start to exude a certain scent. With a stomach full of buffalo contents as well, you'll also probably find that the odd digestive gas might escape him every now and again. Morning. How's it? And that might also add to the general aroma of the vicinity. So far, so good. Been relatively lucky. Robin is saying that she finds it interesting that he would lie down in the road and not in the grass. Robin, I think, to be completely honest, I think it's more comfortable for him. First of all, it's just been graded, so the dirt is loose. Sorry, hold on 1 second. Just want to chat to Mike. Okay, Brent is on it. I just need to update them on the Game Drive channel. Brent just chattering away. I need to try and update Mike on what's happening. Mike, Aubrey's pulled out of the sightings and yours is on his way. We've just been joined by an Elephant Plains vehicle, but I'll let you know as soon as they move out of the sighting, you can come in. Here we go. That's sorted for now. Copy that, yours, no problem. But yes, fortunately, this morning I shall be protected from the pungent odours of the lion. I do think, however, he's going to be a particularly smelly individual if we were to get up close and personal with him. It's such a beautiful view of his foot. And you can see so clearly the three lobes at the back of the foot that we always talk about. And then that callus around his heel. Hello. Oh, my goodness, look at you. Just look at him. He looks looks like something out of, I don't know. Oh, such a big yawn. Is he thinking about getting up, or does he just want to be on his back? Oh, we were sorry. Before I go back to chatting about his paws, I was actually talking about why he's lying in the middle of the road. And apart from the fact, I was answering Robin's question, apart from the fact that the soil is nice and loose and soft for him to rest upon, is also, the grass is also damp, whereas the road is not quite as damp. So I think that's one of the reasons why he's chosen to lie in the road, although lions pretty much are fairly not bothered about where they decide to settle. Shame boy, a bit of a fright. Oof, look at that. I think he might go towards the other sighting at Twin Dams. There we go, it is number two with that limp. Boy, definitely favouring his right front paw. He's got a considerable limp. Oh, have a good shake. Get rid of some of that dirt. And Carolyn, you were wondering about that callus on the back behind the back pad of his front foot. And you were wondering what that is. It's basically his heel. So it's a callus for when he lies down. Is he going to go back and lie down? Yes, boy, keep coming. Keep coming. No, don't go that way. Please don't go towards the other lion sighting, because then we're going to have to leave you. Come lie back on our side. Let's reposition quickly. Ahead yours. He's just going to mobile east join the others. I'm just going to let yours go ahead of us, since we've had a bit of a morning to spend with him and there's not that much space. Yes, that's a good boy. Go that way. Keep going that way. Well done, good boy. Oh, he's gonna rub his cheek and then he's going to urine scent mark. You'll probably see him scratching his back feet along that as well. There we go, spraying backwards into the quarry bush. Isn't he magnificent in his own way? Morning. Look at that, walking right past the vehicle. Imagine being the guest in the back there. He's definitely on his way to join the rest of them. Great. I think that at that point we will probably have to temporarily leave the sighting before rejoining at a later stage. Just because we had a bit of a surprise visit from one of the other vehicles. Go ahead, yours. I think that... Go for it. It's fine. We are, but we won't. Don't worry. We'll keep you out. Here we go. We'll let the other vehicles go ahead of us. This is always one of the things about having a sighting of lions on a main road like this, is that absolutely everyone, this falls within essentially everyone's traverse area, and everybody wants to see a male lion walking down the road. That's one of those things. Mike, this Weinman daughter is now mobile east towards the Twin Dam sighting. I'll try and get an idea as to the lineup there. go. Well, stick to the side of him for now. Watch him walk. You can see how that limp has eased up now that he's been walking a little bit. It's definitely worse when he first gets up, a bit stiff. And then it eases as he starts to move. He's still favoring it. I can't work out exactly where that injury is or what has caused it. His ankle seems a bit swollen, and I think maybe there's the possibility of a break. Let's just go around this vehicle quickly. Now, Nemo is watching his limp and is wondering if it's not more his shoulder than it is his foot or his ankle. Let's just see if we can. I'm going to go ahead of him and I'm going to see if I can get a view of that before we get stuck behind the other vehicles that are at another sighting. He looks amazing with that. Whoopsie. He does look incredible with that mane all covered in muck. And you could be right, Nemo. Let's try and look at the way that he's going to walk down towards us. He's stopped to have a sniff, probably, of the scent marking from the rest of the coalition. I don't know if it's my imagination that his ankle looks a bit more swollen than normal. Doesn't it look a little bit like it's bulging around just where that callus is that Carol was asking about? Oh, that looked a bit sore. And I mean, that kind of injury could even have come from a hunting accident. So whilst attempting to hunt buffalo, oh, lions in the mist, doesn't get better than this. Come on, Dave, use your weight. Need to roll the vehicle back. Here we go. I'll duck my head down. Okay, I'm going to let him come past us. It's amazing, that half-dirty mane, half-clean mane. Looking up to go and join the other two. Now, there are three vehicles at... There are three vehicles at the other sighting, which means that we're going to have to leave him once he reaches that point. As we watch him retreat down, I don't think that we're going to have to wait long before we go back into that sighting. I don't think the vehicles are going to be staying there for too long. So we should have them all to ourselves very soon. Buddy. No, he's going to stop and scent mark. There you go. He's going to wander off down the road. I'm going to pull out of the sighting for now, just because it's getting very close to being one conflated combination. There's three vehicles at Twin Dams. There's another vehicle approaching. We're going to leave them be for now. And we'll let yours go ahead of us. I'm just going to pop us back on the road so we can watch him wander off. Here we go. Watch him wandering down the road. Doug in Arizona was wondering a little bit about whether or not he might be temporarily from the rest of his coalition because of his limp. There you can see where the other vehicles are. That's where the rest of the Birmingham boys are, or at least two of the rest of the Birmingham boys are. He's looking to find them. Doug, possibly, might not have been able to keep up with the pace that they set, but male lions do that when moving about as a group. Some of them might move further ahead. One might decide, actually, I'd quite like a nap just about now, and lie down and let the others get ahead of him. So at the moment, he's trying to relocate, probably just through scent and through sight alone, maybe gauging it off where he heard them calling from before. You can see his indecision in a way as to which way he decides to go. He's just trying to make sure he doesn't miss them. And this is actually a perfect view for us to watch him wander down the road and back towards the other two. Now, as I said, I'm fairly certain that once he gets there, the three of them will stay there. They'll probably spend the rest of the day sleeping there. Every now and again, there's a hint of blue sky, which means the temperatures are going to go back up again. We'll probably find that they'll find themselves some shade and park off there. So although we can't follow him into the sighting now, we will be able to rejoin at a later stage. I agree. James Richards took the thought out of my mouth. James Richards has said that he looks a little bit like Harvey Dent this morning with his half dark face and half clean face. It's exactly what I was thinking about. Harvey Dent, of course, being Two-Face in Batman, for those of you who maybe didn't get the reference. It's exactly what he looked like. Mate, I hope you guys got some extraordinary screenshots of him walking down the road towards us. Looks like is he going to go to the south or is he going to go to the north? Apparently, somebody has said that there are two other Birmingham boys a bit further to the south of where he is, so he could go either way. Will he choose to go left or will he choose to go right? For us, of course, left is better, but it's entirely up to him where he decides to go. Left is on our traverse area, right is not. Absolutely brilliant idea from James Richard. James Richard would like to go back to the spot where he was lying and have a look at the mark that he left. Oh, I thought I heard one of them calling, but I think it's a false alarm. Just listening to the Game Drive channel, as you can imagine, a sighting like this requires a certain degree of coordination amongst the guides. I just need to listen carefully as to who would like to approach. Cool. Right, James, let's go back and have a look at the track. And we'll make our way back towards that sighting once again when everybody's moved off. You tend to find that people, surprisingly, get bored with sleeping lions very quickly. I don't, so I'm happy to wait for our opportunity to go and see them. And you never know what's going to happen. Sleeping lions can go from sleeping to being very awake lions very quickly. I did see Brent surveying the sighting from above. He was on the other side of the hill, watching what was happening. He's very kindly sort of helped to take over coordinating the sighting so that I can talk to you and not have to try and get people into the sighting at the same time. Right, a couple of things actually that might be interesting to check. First of all, is it visible in his track that he's limping? Go ahead, yours. Copy that, thanks, yours. I'm just going back to have a look at his tracks. There we go, so we've got the scuffed patch of dirt here. Now that is from where he stopped and scraped his feet against the dirt and sprayed urine. I'm not sure if it was him or if it was one of the other males. I didn't observe exactly whether or not this was the exact position, but that is definitely lion. You can actually even see, if you look sort of, I don't really want to get out right now, just in case there are other Birmingham boys and there are lots of vehicles around. But if you have a look sort of roughly around the top right of that track, you can almost see the hock mark of his foot. So the extended part of the ankle. So that is where he stopped and scraped. Just trying to have a look at his tracks now. I don't see any visible signs that that limp is showing in his tracks, but it's difficult to tell because all, at least three of them, have walked down this road. So their tracks are all meshed together. My expectation would be that there is a slight drag to the front right foot. You might even see a bit of dirt dragged a bit further forward or flicked a bit further forward by the toes. But it's so difficult to tell which tracks are his in this particular respect. And this is where he, when I said to you, this is, oh, that looked sore. If we have a look a little bit further to the right where he came down from the slope, a little bit further, Dave, to the right here, where that strange patch of soil is. Keep going, up a little bit. Keep going to the right. Perfect, thank you. There, where his tracks came down, that's where I said, oh, that looked like a sore step. He put most of his weight down on his right front as he came down the hill a little bit. But I can't see, all I can really see is that he twisted his track ever so slightly in the dirt. But difficult to gauge exactly how clear that limp will be in the track in future. That's a pleasure, James. One last thing that we have to do is just go back to where we had him lying down, since that is what I promised to do. This isn't where he was lying. This is just where he was walking. So let's just go back there quickly so we can have a look at that track. The millipedes as we go. They're all out rejoicing in the moisture. Hopefully none of the vehicles have come and driven over where he was lying down. I'm not sure. We might get lucky. This is exactly what we love to do, and it's James Richards' suggestion was a really good one, because coming back and looking at a track where you know exactly what happened is the best way to learn to track. So he was lying just off here. We can actually almost see some of the marks on the ground from where he's left stomach contents a bit further to the, a bit further down, Dave. He's, there we go. And a bit further to the right, sort of in between those tire tracks. Up a little bit and right a little bit. If I can't quite reach there. That discoloured spot right next to the tyre track. That is where he was lying. So they have been driven over ever so slightly, but James is right. This is the best way to learn to track. It's not that clear because the sun is not out, so it's not catching it at the right angle. It's not all that clear for us to see. But at least you'll know in future what it looks like when a lion is sleeping. You can see the discoloration from where he was lying and where he imparted the buffalo's stomach contents upon the soil. And I've stopped now because I'm trying to just double check and see if I can't see exactly which tracks are his and if I can see evidence of the limp. But it doesn't look all that clear. Let's just try one loop. Try and get the light a little bit better for us. But I think it's going to be tricky in these kind of conditions. Oh, goodness, much like driving Wendy at the moment. I'm not a completely useless driver, I promise. Wendy's stalling for all of us. She's very lacking in power. There, actually, that's nice, and that's a bit clearer. You can see where he was lying, right in between the vehicle tracks. Where the grass just ends there. That is where he was lying. You can see the flattened part. There we go, perfect. This angle is much better. Sorry, Dave, this is a much easier angle. Okay, wonderful. Well, I'm going to move on, but not too far. I'm going to wait for my chance to go into that sighting with the lions. While I do that, I wonder how Brent's morning is going. Let's find out how things look from a different angle.
So we've got a juvenile battalier prepping and preening, trying to get rid of some of that moisture, which looks like it has stopped for a while, but it is definitely coming through in waves, this light drizzle. Okay. Mike, you can keep moving. I've just got a battalier here. Here we go. You can see there. Now, it takes a juvenile battalier about 8 years to get its adult coloration. I'm going to see if we can sneak a bit closer. Sometimes these young guys let us get really close to them. Oh no, roll car. No, dear. Oh, there we go. It did roll just far enough. There we go. You can see he's starting to get the coloration on his beak and on his feet. Watching us through the gap. I'm gonna try and sneak an inch further forward. So, Lucy in Indiana asked to find some birds. She's got 199 on her bird list. And Lucy, if you've got 199, I'm pretty sure the battalier is one of the ones you've got already. But we will definitely try and find an obscure little bird for you to spot on the safari. Hello. Watching us quite intently there. And you can just see that big talon sticking over the branch in the bottom right. You can see his big toe there. Now, battaliers are a type of snake eagle. Oh, he's tired. It's been a long night sitting in the rain. Although they have a very different feeding strategy to the other snake eagle species. They are expert scavengers. They will hunt for themselves, but they are often the first bird to find a carcass. And vultures will even watch, and if they see a battalier drop down to the ground, they will almost always come investigate. And of course, this cold, oh, another yawn, overcast weather, it's not great for vultures, and we haven't been seeing too many of them. They're unable to ride those thermals up high. Nice bit of preening going on. Can you hear the rest of the birds waking up? Pirate Jack says, this is awesome. Can we find him a black eagle? They used to be his high school mascot. Unfortunately, no black eagles in the Sabi Sands. They prefer mountainous areas. They need cliffs for nesting. So we're not going to see any on the live safaris, unfortunately, unless there's a very confused and lost one. Not enough big mountains or koppies or little hills in this part of the world. Baba Batalia.
What kind of work location? Section, give me an update. I saw the one that already
has with Jamie. Sorry, just listening to the radio?
Otherwise, I'm going back north. Will you give me maybe they start moving a little bit north. Will you tell me? Okay, I'll do that. Because I heard someone said there's Imwe also in the area now. Yeah, I'm sure it's somewhere far on the Kikari. There's some other gala Kikari, the way that this guy's talking.
Sorry, just getting an update there. So, we're going to continue our search for leopards. So what we're doing is we've checked this northern boundary, the eastern boundary, and now we're going to start zigzagging through the center of Juma, hoping to find some fresh tracks on top of the rain. So, James, Richard, and Nature is Beautiful would love to see the Anderson male. Has he been seen recently? Anderson male doesn't quite extend this far where we're checking now. His territorial boundary is in Arethusa for the moment, but as far as I know, he's down south on Londolozi, so he hasn't been seen in a while. Robin in Maryland says she thought when an eagle opens his beak like that, he's not only yawning but also moving food from his crop through to his belly. That's a slightly different movement, Robin. They sort of will do a very similar thing, but they'll keep that mouth open and sort of and try and move that food from their crop down into their gullet. But so at that time, I think he was just having a yawn. He was depleted of oxygen. This is one of Karula's favorite hunting areas. I was hoping to see a track or hear an alarm call. And welcome to Sensational TKO, who would like to know, is this happening now? It is.
We are live from the African bush on Juma Private Game Reserve. And so far this morning, we found elephants and lions. I'm in search of leopards at the moment, but we'll see what else is about there. So don't go anywhere. Don't go anywhere and enjoy the live safari. But Jamie has found a feathered friend for you guys to look at. So let's go see what it is.
Right up until that exact moment, there was a kingfisher sitting on the branch. Unfortunately, it flew away as we were linking. It was one very bedraggled looking brown-headed kingfisher. I actually got really excited because I thought it was a grey-headed. Let's see if I can try and find it again for you. And try not to do what Scott did the last time he tried to show everyone a bird, which was accidentally drive into a marula tree. It was a very big marula tree as well. Where'd it go? Oh, I'm sorry. It has flown away, and I think it has flown quite far away. Oh well, you win some, you lose. Signal break up there, so we won't go that road. I can hear the dwarf mongoose calling. Let's see if we can't spot them. My suspicion is that they're on the other side of the drainage line in the termite mound. I'm just listening to the Game Drive channels again. Perfect. Okay, I'm just making sure that we can get back into that Birmingham boy sighting. See if we can't find these dwarf mongoose. I can hear them. All gone quiet. Oh well. It is the joy of a live safari that things don't always stick around when you want them to. Just trying to see if I can't find them. Now, we spoke a little bit about vultures, and hopefully my signal will hold up for us to continue going straight. But Maggie in Western Australia has been listening carefully to our comments about vultures thermaling and the fact that in this cold, damp weather, they cannot... or they have to wait for quite a long time before there's warm air rising that allows them to thermal. And Maggie was wondering then, how do they find enough food in winter? Well, Maggie, as far as I know, similar to the Australian winters, during the day with the sun out, and of course for us it's our dry season, so there's no rain. I'm just checking to see again if I can't locate these dwarf mongoose for you. I don't want to travel too far before I've answered your question, Maggie. During the day, the sun is out because it's not cloudy. So even though it's not as warm as it is during summer, it's warm enough to create that warm air rising and the thermals that they need to, in order to survive and find their food, as you said, by sight and by thermaling. So they definitely don't go hungry during the winter season. It's only on these, it's more the cold and cloudy days when it's a bit rainy, that the ground is a bit damp and it doesn't exude the same warmth. But even today, we'll probably start to see vultures in the next few hours as the ground heats up, because I can feel the temperature rising already. And they will be absolutely fine. It's just that they tend to be a bit more grounded in the damp weather. And of course, vultures can fly without... That thermaling for them is the best way of, or the most energy efficient way of searching for food. X-Ranger has said, imagine if every time we linked to it that had flown away, we got a dollar, and how rich we would be. Yes, I about trying to calculate for the next week or so just how much money we would be earning. If we did that, it'd be hilarious to calculate. I would be a very wealthy woman, especially given the current exchange rate. I think that we would be raking the money in. It is one of just the joys of a live safari. It's live. So if it flies, it flies away. Trying to put something on camera with wings isn't always the easiest deal. It's the same with the bush babies, trying to catch them on camera. But in a way, I think that, I actually think that adds to the whole experience. It's all real and raw. I'm just keeping an ear out on the Game Drive channel. We will be making our way back into that Birmingham Boys sighting, but it is going to take us a while. There are lots and lots of vehicles that are cycling through. And because it's a sighting that is on a main road, there's vehicles from all around coming to visit. And they're all having their chance to allow their guests to enjoy that Birmingham Boys sighting. Checking carefully along this road. The leopards love this area. Ooh, wonderful question from Debbie. And in order to answer it, I'm actually going to get my phone out for Debbie's question. She said that she's asking about a post that I think Brent put up, but I've also got a picture of it on my phone. Let me just make sure. Sorry, my apologies for my lack of technical abilities. Debbie's actually asked about this little creature. Oh, is it better that way? Now, that is a pseudo-scorpion. And to give you a sense of scale, that hand, that ring is my ring. So that's my middle finger there. That is where it was sitting between my two fingers. So you get a really nice idea of just how tiny this little creature was. I had such fun experimenting with Jerry's macro lens attached to my phone. Getting him in focus was something of a difficult exercise. Now, Debbie, this pseudo scorpion, it's one of the first ones I've ever seen, or at least managed to get a photo of. And Steph said it was one of the biggest he's ever seen, just to give you an idea of how tiny they are. They don't have a tail. I know that's not as clear. They don't have a scorpion-like tail. But the reason they're known as pseudo-scorpions, they're amazing, actually. They're like the most incredible mixture between spiders and scorpions. There's venom within their pincers themselves, and not just venom in the pincers. They also have spinnerets, so they can produce silk. So they can embed their silk with venom in their ways of catching their prey. And while he was doing this, he was sort of spreading webbing all the way across my hands as he was walking across. Not dangerous to us. I mean, they really are not of any kind of threat. And it's such a small size. But definitely one of the most fascinating creatures I have encountered out here. They live on little mites, clothing moth larvae, anything like that that they can catch that they are, is small enough for them to consume. This particular guy was in the abdomen of a longhorn beetle, a much larger longhorn beetle, that was slowly dying, and it was busy collecting all of the mites that were on it. So that, Debbie, was the pseudo scorpion. Such a brilliant little creature. The fascinating tiny things that we have out here. I think I definitely should go the route of Brent in terms of investing in an iPad. I'm just going to show you. See if I get it. Got it in slow motion. I did get it in slow motion. Him moving. So you get a really nice perspective of the scale. Look at me with my slow motion videos. It's very out of focus though. There you can see four legs plus the pincers. And you really get a sense of just how tiny this little creature is. You can see how clear the prints and calluses, charming calluses, on my hands are. A combination of driving and using saws, pangas, hammers, and all kinds of things. There we go. The the video of the pseudo scorpion. Now that bird that's calling has become my nemesis bird. Let's just listen for a second. Can you hear it calling? That is a southern boo-boo. Dave and I spotted it the last time. We didn't manage to get it on camera. Again, joys of live safaris. It's not the Cape turtle dove that's calling off behind it. It's the whistle. Southern boo-boo. One day we're going to get it on camera. They love these thick drainage line areas. That's where they like to hang out and spend a little bit of their time, or most of their time, in really, really thick vegetation, which is why I've named it my nemesis. I see him. Oh my goodness, how exciting. Dave, on the other side of the drainage line, there's a tree with sort of brownish seeds. He's on the tree to the right of that. There he is, brilliant. Hey, so much for my nemesis bird. There we go. A southern boo-boo. And there you can see just why they are so difficult to manage to get on camera. Fluttering about in the thick vegetation. Might not be the best view in the world, but still counts as a victory. Yes, Dave, we managed it, finally. So exciting. I'm very chuffed. Brilliant stuff. Right, from the little things to some of the largest on our reserve, I think that Brent has managed to catch up once again with an elephant herd. So why don't you jump on the back with him?
Zoom in. We've got a squirrel alarm calling. Ian thought he just spotted a snake, so we're just trying to see.
What is that? I don't know, what is that?
It's a piece of a giant plated lizard. Where did you spot that? That's been eaten by something else, probably by a predatory bird. I wonder if that's what the squirrel was alarm calling at. Something was eating that giant plated lizard. We were hoping for leopard, but... just have a quick look. The fact that that squirrel jumped across the ground means it could be a predatory bird, but this particular area is favored by quite a few different leopards that we've seen regularly. Cool. Let's see where that squirrel's actually looking. Seriously upset. Looking, so there's the squirrel. Oh, no. Yes, there he is. That little dot there. And he's looking down towards this drainage system, so we're going to do the same. He's seriously upset. Come on, Karula. We're just going to concentrate and try to see what the squirrel's alarm calling at. Very upset. Just pop our nose in here where we can see down into this little drainage system. The squirrel's looking into these thickets here. So, what I'm going to do is there's a little bit of high ground there. So while you're with me, I'm going to pop my head over the edge. Maybe there's a leopard there.
squirrel was looking down here. So it's going to be quite difficult to get a vehicle in there. So before we try bash and crash, I'm going to have a quick little poke into these thickets. Hear the squirrel getting louder and louder. Very upset. There is something here. I can't see anything, but that squirrel's not stopping. And the way it's calling, I don't think it's alarming at a snake, but maybe that a leopard popped across there. I'm just gonna check around a little bit, see if we can find some tracks. If we don't find any tracks, I'm gonna take a more serious stroll into the bushes. For animals, all these little clues are what help us find them. Squirrels alarming, Franklin alarming, impala, kudu, all the different animals will let you know if there's a predator around. Now, with a small animal like a squirrel, sometimes it can be a little bit difficult because being so small, so many different things will eat them. So birds, snakes, leopards. What is that? That's hyena. I got very excited for a second there. It just looked like a leopard track. Now we're just going to pop onto the other side of this drainage line, see what's there, and while we do that, Jamie's got some birds that are doing some alarm calling.
And as with our kingfisher, they immediately stopped. The birds demonstrating an incredible sense of humor this morning. They stopped as Brent sent you back across to me. They were actually having a bit of an argument, these crested Franklin, all calling at each other. Two of the males actually got involved in a brief scuffle before separating. Aw, Franklin. Oh, they might start calling again now that the others are calling. Let's just have a look at the group that's going to go across the road because I think that they're going to call again. Come on. Come on. Oh, have a look at the spur on the back of the leg, if you can. Now they're going into the grass. I'll actually show you a picture in my book. Franklin, despite their sort of harmless-looking figure, are capable of inflicting quite, or fighting quite viciously between each other. And I'll show you a picture of exactly what that spur looks like. And that's what's given them the name, or why they are related to a group of birds known as the spur fowls. Let me try and find the good example here. All of them have them. This will actually be a fine example. It's not the one I was looking for, but nevertheless, we get the right idea. It's not the same bird that we've been looking at, but it does give a really nice, clear picture of what I mean when I say spur. They've got these extended toes at the back that are hardened and have claws on the end of them, and they use those, particularly the males, when in competition for access to the ladies. And some of the spur fowls even have, if we look up at, for example, this one, they even have more than one spur along the backs of the legs. Now, this is definitely not a bird that you will see here. This is localized endemic to Ethiopia, but it's all part of the same family, so it demonstrates exactly what I mean. It's a hardwood spur fowl, if you were interested. Not one that I've ever seen. Now, Ethiopia is definitely on my top of the, or one of the top of the list that are places that I would love to go to see the bird life and the animal life there. Oh, there's some incredible stuff there. The Ethiopian red wolf would be an animal that I would be so excited to see. Now that, as far as I know, is the most endangered predator in Africa. And it is quite literally a wolf-like animal that lives on the tops of the mountain ranges up there in a very, very localized, isolated population. Franklin, fair enough, farewell. It's amazing, they love to chirp over me whenever I'm talking, but when I want to stop and look at them doing it, they all went quiet. I promise you, these animals definitely have a sense of irony. And a warm welcome to Nick in Nevada, who has been watching for the last week or so. And Nick, as a fairly new viewer, was very curious about why the animals don't run away from the vehicle. And Nick, we've got a nice example here of animals that are going to move away from us. It depends very much on the animal species concerned. So we've got a lovely herd of Inyala here. Now, this is an antelope species that likes to be out in the open. I'm sorry, doesn't like to be out in the open, but prefers thicker and denser vegetation. They're playing in the back there. This is the perfect weather to watch antelope play. Even Inyala do it regularly. They bounce around. We had an incredible sighting. Sorry, Nick, I haven't forgotten you. But we had this incredible sighting with a young male that was basically doing an obstacle course, round and round in circles. I think it might even be the same young males that we're looking at now, because it's a very similar area. Go forward, maybe we can get a better view from there. Nick, so it depends very much on the animal. Now, the Nyala, as soon as they settled in a thicker vegetation area, they immediately relaxed with our presence. But for animals like our lions, our elephants, leopards, and so on, they have grown up with vehicles around them from the earliest age possible, and their mothers the same before them. Unfortunately, our Nyala going off into behind the trees. But let's use the Birmingham boys from this morning as an example. They've grown up in a pride where they have seen vehicles throughout their lives. Now, the process of habituation is a long one. So wild animals are naturally afraid of the vehicle initially, which is why we've spoken before about that skittish leopard that hangs out around Biffles Hook Dam that clearly hasn't grown up here. He's a dispersal male. He's moved away from wherever he was born in search of fresh genetics to mate with and to pass on his genes. So that's very common, leopards moving about, and every now and again the Sabi Sands gets a leopard that is a truly wild leopard that has come from somewhere where they've hardly ever seen vehicles and cars. It's very easy if animals are habituated from the very beginning. And it's so important, it is an underestimated part of what we do, or the way in which it contributes to the conservation of these animals. Because if these animals ran away from vehicles every time they were seen, tourists would not pay money to come here, lodges would not exist, and therefore conservation areas would actually really struggle to pay the bills that are required for keeping a wilderness area like this protected. Fencing, for example, anti-poaching patrols, research going into the impact of different man-made structures and so on. I mean, you get the idea as to why the financial support of tourism is so essential. And as a country, it is vital for our survival. So starting reserves that are starting up in a wilderness area where the animals are not so relaxed, with leopards and lions, what they have often done in the past, they don't need to do that anymore because we have plenty of relaxed leopards from birth. But what they used to do in the sort of 60s, 70s, is they would take an antelope, a dead antelope, and they would put it in a tree as bait, essentially. And they'd wait for the leopard to come and feed on it. Let's use a leopard for an example. And then what they'd do is they'd just park the car off as far as possible while still seeing the leopard feeding, and leave the vehicle, leave it with the radio on for days, and repeat that process for days and weeks and months until they got to the point where that animal started realizing that the vehicle was of absolutely no threat to them and allowed it to approach closely. And then from there, especially if you habituate a female, you have got future generations that will then be habituated by her behavior, because the cubs, the animals, the baby animals will learn from the behavior of their mothers. And if mom doesn't run away from this big scary thing, then they don't need to either. Now that's something that has happened many years ago in this area, which is why our animals are so relaxed. And it's such a pleasure because it means that we don't have any kind of major impact on their behavior. So the lions go about their daily business as they would regardless of whether or not we were there. Look at this beautiful Inyala bull. Wrong direction, buddy, they went that way. The ladies went south. You're going north. Not sure how clearly you can see it, but there's mud all over the top of his horns. What a beautiful animal. So what he's been doing is thrashing his head in a muddy pan. Nobody knows exactly why they do that. One of the theories is that it's to rub the scent glands between their eyes, around there, so the preorbital glands. Another theory is that it makes them look big and strong, and the more mud you pack on your horns, the bigger you look. Kudu do it as well. Wildebeest occasionally do it. Only ever the males. So it's probably a function of them competing for the attentions of the females and with each other for access to the females. So Nick, the answer to your question is not a short one, but it is a very, very important aspect of the way in which conservation areas like the Sabi Sands, and the Sabi Sands is such a good example of habituation done right, to the point that the animals are so incredibly accustomed to the vehicles that they aren't really affected by them at all. We often speak about the DRC, and I've just picked up a passenger in the form of a buffalo thorn ranch. Hold on a second. Release me. Thank you. It's the buffalo thorn in front of me that decided it wanted to come on the game drive with us. Let's try that again. This time, hopefully, it will pass under the vehicle. I don't want to go off-road to get around it. There's no reason to do that, although we're going to have to here. Now, we often speak about our camp, the DRC. And Peggy watching has seen us go past the signs a few times. And I suppose we've never actually really given you an update or spoken about it in the non-abbreviated form. So she saw the sign that says Juma Research Center. and was wondering a little bit about that. Now, the DRC is where we live, Peggy, or where most of the crew lives. There's only a couple of us that live in a separate house. And it was prior to our involvement and prior to us starting up in this area, and I don't know the full history. I must be honest, Peggy, I don't know the full history behind the DRC, but I assume it was a wonderful spot for researchers and students to come and stay within Juma, and the landowners very kindly allowing the students to actually come and do research on their land and to look into anything from probably vegetation surveys to bird monitoring to insect monitoring, right through to monitoring the larger animals like the cats. So I'll look a little bit into the history, Peggy, see if I can't find out about the history to the Juma Research Center, but it makes total sense to me that it was a nice spot for students and researchers to come and conduct their research. All right, I just need to get onto the Game Drive channel. I want to just find out what's happening with those lions. Oh, no, hold on. Somebody else got there before me. Somebody else got in before me again. We'll just wait our turn to have a conversation. They're chatting about quarantine. And quarantine is one of Karula's sons. And he's only recently just left her territorial area in the last year or so. So the update on quarantine was that he was seen crossing into Torchwood late last night. Now, I've actually never seen quarantine, and I've been desperate to. I saw him on the live safari while I was on leave. I was watching it. But I've yet to see him in the flesh, so to speak. He looks like he is a stunning leopard. Something that we can actually look forward to once we start traversing Cheetah Plains. Hopefully we will have more sightings of him in that area, because that seems to be where he's settled for now. You know what, let's just go and investigate that lion sighting. We'll look at it from the top of the crest and see how many vehicles have made their way through there. It sounds like, from what I can hear, Texans saying there's still lots of vehicles waiting to get into that sighting. We'll do some, what would we call it? Reconnoitering. Evidence gathering. We'll go and have a look and see what it looks like from. Luckily, it's in the perfect position for us to go and sit and look from above a crest. And have a look at what's happening to this tree. Let's look here at the bark and the patterns that are along this bark. And this is how elephant action goes about ultimately killing the odd large tree, such as this one. Look at that crisscross of mud. Almost like a vein system in a way. And that's come from termites that are eating their way through. Now that bark was stripped away from the tree by an elephant at some point in the last few months. And now you can really see how that opens up a way for wood borers and termites and other parasites of trees, I suppose you could call them parasites, they're not really technically parasites. Nevertheless, they do harm the trees themselves. This tree is still alive, but you'll probably find that it could well die in the next few months. It's one of the ways that elephants control the environment, or at least have a really large impact on the environment around them, just by opening up almost like a wound in a tree that allows for infection to set in this case, in the form of termites and wood borers. It's not entirely a fair comparison, but you get the idea. It's just such a fascinating pattern, the way that they have moved through the bark. It's quite beautiful in a way. we don't always stop to look at. And I've just taken the opportunity, while we were talking about that, to answer a question from Monkey Man about whether or not we get quails out here. And Monkey Man, yes, we do. But I don't think I've managed to get any on camera. I have seen them once or twice. But here's an example of just two of the quails that we could see here. Relatively unusual. Definitely was a bird that we would get exceptionally excited about seeing. The common quail at the top, and then just below it, the harlequin quail. Both of those do occur here. It's just a matter of seeing them. There's also little birds known as button quails. A little bit further down. This is a button quail. And that's also something that we could see here. Button quails are, you've got to be so careful with them. I worked in an area where they were exceptionally common. And they tend not to fly right up until the last moment. And they very often hide in patches of grass in the middle of the road. This was a particular area that I was working in, didn't have as much traffic on the road, so there was plenty of grass growing up in the middle of it. And you had to be so careful that there weren't button quail, and they are perfectly cryptically colored, especially when in dry grass in the middle of winter. You can barely see them. Tiny little birds, only about, I would say, only really about this big in terms of size, and they would shoot up just at the last minute as you were driving past them. It did mean that you had to, at times, traverse very slowly.